Hop in, babe, we're going.
Woohoo!
Well, your new friends from the Netherlands used to have a house left into the mud, but an old RV called Penelope, she's a 1983. Pictures and patterns of design. Penelope loves driving till the end of time. Well, RVlicious, if you like a vibe, please subscribe. Please subscribe.
Hello, buddies. It's stormy outside.
Stormy.
But we also have stormy news.
We do?
Come here.
Stormy news?
We have some stormy news as well.
Yes.
Because not only do we have a new website, ourrelicious.com, I also made us a new app. Yes, buddies, I made an app. It's the Ourrelicious app. And it's completely free for you guys. If you have an Android device.
Yes.
I'm not we're Android people.
Yeah, we are Android people.
So we made a new app for the phone, and you can download it completely free on ourrelicious.com. And while you're there, you can also download our free ringtone. Or buy a release sticker or other fun stuff.
Yes, exactly.
So it's a handy app. You just download it, install it on your Android device, and it should show you our videos. And you can, every time you open it, it will show you the latest videos of our releases. So how awesome is that? Completely free.
Super awesome.
Super awesome. You want to show them the app?
Yeah. Let's see where it is.
The R.
The R. Ourrelicious. There it is. There's the Ourrelicious app. This is videos featuring Ourrelicious. Second season Ourrelicious. And the first season Ourrelicious. And if you click on it,
you have to click on the text.
Oh, right. Click on the text and you see all the videos of season one.
And what if you choose one?
Nice. Let's choose this one.
And then you can read the info.
Read the info.
You can also give thumbs ups.
Thumbs ups.
You can favorite it.
Favorite it.
Share it.
Share it.
And play it.
And play it.
Here, we got a round sink and a square box.
Oh. So. And then you can go back.
Yep.
And then you're back.
And then you're back. Nice.
We can also go to ourrelicious.com. This is our new website, ourrelicious.com. The mobile version. You just scroll down to the bottom and there it says, get the free Ourrelicious app for Android. Never miss a video from Pet and Pat again. And download it.
Nice.
Easy as that.
It's ridiculous.
It's ridiculously easy.
Ridiculously easy.
Yes. I also built an app for my copywriting website.
Awesome.
PatrickHavekaarten.com. Let's check that out. Just go to ourrelicious.com and click on Pat's website. Which will take you to Pat's website. And on Pat's website, if you scroll to the bottom, it says download my free app. Always your own copywriter within
reach.
The free app of Patrick Heijvergeten. How awesome is that?
Super awesome.
So let's open up my app.
Yes, this is my app.
There it is. This one.
Let's step on it.
Step on it. This is my app. It's a simple contact app.
Mm-hmm.
It takes you to either my website by clicking on this link, or it shows you my email.
Mm-hmm. Let's see if it opens a program. Yes.
It opens up Gmail, for example.
Yes. Wow.
And then you can send me a mail instantly with the free app.
Ooh, that's nice.
So how awesome is that?
Super awesome. Amazingly awesome.
Yeah, I made it myself.
Superb.
Superb. Yes, it's a free. It's a nice addition. Mm. So if you download the app, just let us know what you think of it and if it works at all.
Exactly.
Hello, buddies. So you might be in a situation that you need a new job, or you are thinking about getting a new job, or maybe you know somebody around you who is looking for a new job, and maybe that person is saying, I've been applying and applying for months or even years, and I never get invited to a job interview. Well, if that is the case, if you hear somebody like that, then tell them to watch this video, or if you're in that situation, then this video is for you. Hello there, buddies. So it is stormy outside, so I hope you can hear us correctly. It's Patrick and co-host Petra.
Hello.
I want to show you guys today how I quick scan a resume and a cover letter.
Mm-hmm.
They're in Dutch, but I think you find it interesting even for English, because basically the principle is universal, and I will just go quick scan through it, and I think you might learn something from it. Anyway, a lady approached me and she said, could you quick scan my text, my resume and my cover letter? And this is a lady who has been unemployed since 2008. So that's almost 10 years now. I told her that her cover letter and resume would possibly be interesting for the video to show you guys. So I asked her, I said, how would you like to have it for free if in exchange I may use your resume as an example on my YouTube show and Petra's YouTube show, of course. And she agreed, so on the condition that I would anonymize her name and the companies that she worked for. So that's the only thing I changed. So I went in earlier, I changed her name, I changed the address and the phone number. And now we're going in, and I'm going to quick scan it. I'm just going to quick scan it live. Let me give you a little bit of backstory on this lady. I asked her, how do you apply for jobs? And she told me honestly that she just has one cover letter and one resume that she sends with all job applications. She basically just copy and pastes the texts and sends it to the employers. And she has sent tens to hundreds of job applications, and she never got invited once with her resume and cover letter. It never led to a phone call asking her, can you come and chat with us because you're a potential candidate. So basically she used the same files for 9 years, and I'm sure that a lot of people out there do that too. Let's go in and have a look. So let's look at this lady's letter. The first thing that I noticed when I quick scan it, this is very short. This is hardly 50 words. I count 4 sentences of text. So if you're really serious about working with a company, even without having looked at the content of the sentences, I already know that this is way too short.
Mm-hmm.
So that's hopefully that the content that is there. Let's hope that that content at least is to the point and powerful. It could be. It could be that one magical sentence that lands you the job immediately. Is this the case in this case? Let's see. Because it's so short,
you also create an expectation that there cannot be any spelling error in there. Because it's so short, it will stand out like a sore thumb. So if I find one spelling error, then basically you're already out of the game. So let's see, Netterdam, that's just the fake name that I changed it to. And it says date August 1. And the word date in Dutch is spelled wrong. So there she goes already. In the first sentence, she spelled the word date with an N in Dutch. And that has to be an M, three legs, and not an N, two legs. So, or as to say in German, Zweibein, Dreibein. So she made a Zweibein, and it has to be a Dreibein. So, concerning job, the vacancy as manager. Sorry, buddies. See, quick scanning is a lot of fun. Copywriting, especially changing other people's text, is a lot of fun. But you can have lots of laughs. It never hurts to have a good laugh about this. So, if you're serious about the job, then you have to write it. It's assistant manager, but she shortened it off as ass manager. It would be polite to at least make a capital letter here and just write the function also in capital letters. And don't shorten it. Don't use briefs. Just write the whole thing, because the text is already so short. Dear Mrs. Linden, well, at least she took the trouble of finding the name of the contact for the vacancy. It's a bit formal, but it's okay. I have read that you have a vacancy. This is what the first sentence tells us. I have read that you have a vacancy. That's a pretty lame sentence to start off with. It's pretty boring. It's redundant, basically, because if you hadn't read that there is a vacancy, you wouldn't have applied. So this whole sentence is just filling. It's just filling. And if you write something like this, then you should write, I have read on a website, and you have to name the website. You have to name, I've read in a newspaper, and just name where you read it. But in this case, it's just totally redundant and boring to start off with that. It's yawning. So let's remove that sentence, because, yeah, it's completely useless. My interest is very big. This is what she writes in the next sentence. My interest is very big. Okay, nice to know. My belly is very big. But I think what she means to say is my interest in the job is very big. And then I ask myself the question, okay, why are you interested in this job then? Can you tell me something about why are you interested? And this is not something she mentions. So this is not a good sentence. My interest is very big. That's nice for you, but yeah, what's the point of it? So also useless sentence. And then next sentence she writes, I hope that I can be of meaning for your company. And here's another spelling mistake. In Dutch, you have to write it with a W. So that's, there you go. Then you have two spelling mistakes already in very short text. I hope that I can accomplish something for your company in this job. Yeah, that I hope, that everybody hopes that. But what I need to know is why? Why hope? Shouldn't you know that? Hope is something that belongs in it. It's very passive, yes. If you say, I know that I can be of value to your company, that's a very different sentence. And you can say, I think I'm of value for your company because of this and because of my experience. But that she doesn't write. She doesn't write anything that would make me consider
hiring her. And this is the mail that she sent for almost 9 years to a lot of companies. She says, I'm very eager to learn. And in the Dutch, it's another spelling mistake, it's one word. So three spelling mistakes and a short text. Four sentences, eh? And I already have three mistakes. I'm very eager to learn, and I like broadening my horizon of knowledge. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I should hire you because you're eager to learn. So you're telling me you don't have experience then? I write nothing about why are you interested in this job? What do you bring to the table? Do you have matching experience, the different experience that can be of value? Nothing in there. So that you're eager to learn and you like broadening your horizon, that's nice for you, but that doesn't get you invited, of course. Basically, she hasn't said anything of content that would make me or anybody consider hiring somebody. Then she writes, thank you very much in advance, which is also a spelling mistake. So we have here four spelling mistakes. And then we have the closing statement is her name, Miss of Mrs. STL Jensen. This is a fake name, but she also used this three letters abbreviation, her Christian name, so to say. But it's very formal. This is also very formal, Mrs. Linden. And thank you very much. And then, why? Thank you for what? Yeah? Basically, that's not how you close a sentence. Basically, in Dutch, you say, well, with kind regards. You don't say thank you very much because there's nothing to thank for yet. So that we remove too, just removing the faulty sentences. So if she's called Sharon, for example, then I would just say with kind regards. I would leave the Mrs. out because it's very formal. So it would be something like this. Huh? With kind regards, Sharon Jensen. That makes it a person, but if you have an abbreviation, then you don't even know what the name is of the applicant. So as you can see, basically she wrote a few sentences, four sentences, four mistakes in a very short text. It's hardly 50 words, so it's in every 10 words almost it's one mistake. That's a lot of mistakes. So it's a very, as you can see, it's a very empty letter and not how you write a good letter to get invited with at all. So, but I know that a lot of people write letters like this, and that way it's a good example. So enough with that. Let's delete that letter. It's completely useless. But it's, at the same time, it's a shame because if you write a letter with hardly any content, with no value in it, or not even any explanation why you would want to work there, besides the obvious, hello, do you have a job? I'm interested, let me know. That's not really a goal-getter mentality, of course. So maybe the resume is better. Let's check it out. So let's first have a look, see at the resume. As you can see, it's two pages, and I must say, usually attention spans of people who read a lot of job resumes to make a selection, as you can see already, as I quick scan this, and my first impression is, why is this two pages? This should fit on one page. So I'm going to see if I can get it to one page by making some tweaks, but two pages, that tells me that this person was not to the point enough to fit it into one page. So with a little bit more effort, that's my first impression. And as you can see also, let me zoom in here. Let's see, how do I zoom in? Yeah, okay, I'm zooming in. And immediately you can see some errors. You can see this is bold, and underscored. And that's a big no-no in writing texts, to use both bold and underscored at the same time. Usually you should either choose the underscore or the bold. And here the same thing, underscore and bold. But you see how sloppy the underscore, that this line, so to say, this line, it should end where the N ends, where the last letter of the word ends. The underscore should end, just like here with competitions and work experience. So this is already, the first look at it is very sloppy. It's a very sloppy mistake to make. And it's very easily fixable, because if I go in and I backspace, I fix it. As you can see, I fix. It's an easy fix. So imagine this sloppy underscore and bold, with the underscore going too far, is very sloppy. So I hate underscores, so I'm just gonna leave the bold. So I'm gonna the bold and the beautiful. Yes, Petra is the beautiful. And already that looks better. If I look at it again, it already looks better. But let us go back here and zoom in again. Let me zoom out again. As you can see, or not, but I'm going to tell you, this lady probably used a template for her resume. And the reason I say that, because it has words here like personal features, competences. Usually, a lot of people use a template. They pull it from the internet and then they just customize it. But if you customize it, then you have to fill in the blanks. And as you can see, she has blanks under personal, notes, personal features, and competences. She left it blank. It's really strange. She left the blanks. So it's like she says, I don't know anything personal and I don't have any competences. If you leave it blank, it looks like you forgot something. Now I notice something again. Let me close this document. Save it. I forgot to tell you, buddies, if you look at the title of the document, this is how she sent it actually to an employer. It says Curriculum Vitae. And Curriculum Vitae is Latin. It means the course of life. Mm-hmm. And description of your life, of your basically your professional life. The E and the A are reversed. So even if I hadn't opened the document yet, I would think, hey, this person made a spelling error in the title of the document already. So let's change that. This is how it's supposed to. And then the V should be a capital letter. And then functional 2006. Now that's also very sloppy, because functional, that's probably the something that was in the template. And the 2006, I mean, she still used this in 2007 and 2008. So if you leave it at 2006, then you're basically telling the employer that you've been unemployed for 2 years already. So this should just be CV and then first name, last name. First and last name of this lady. CV, Sharon Jensen. There you go. Or if you're not sure how you spell it, just rename it. Let's see, rename it. Make it yourself easy into CV. CV of Sharon Jensen. That looks much better. You can also write resume based on the title alone with a spelling error in it. That could be the end of your chances. Let's open it again. So if I look at the first part, you see name, address, place where you live, nationality, phone. But what I miss is the first name again. And you miss the personalization. If you use abbreviations, STL, to shorten your name, that makes you very objectifies you, basically. It unpersonalizes you. So if you want to be taken serious, you should should just write your name, Sharon Jensen. Full on. What I also miss is how old is this lady. I don't see the date of birth. I don't see stuff like that. So I have no idea how old is this. Sometimes people are looking for somebody in their 30s or in their 40s or 50s or 60s. So it would help if she would write how old she was. Like if she was 61, you could just say 61. You could also write your place of a date of birth in there. If I look, this is a handy feature, I can count spaces. So I can see that there's too many spaces in 11. Between the street name just needs one space, and then there's three spaces for the floor name. Third floor, and then there's some bunch of spaces at the end too, but that's not visible. But there's already sloppiness in something as writing the address down. So phone number, it's also nice to split up the phone number a little bit to make it easier for people to read it. So if you look at the phone number, now it looks more relaxed already. But I also miss, but that, I mean, people out there have various opinions on this. What I miss is a picture. You could just easily put a picture in your resume. This needs to be capital. This space can go. I would write this curriculum vitae of Sharon Jensen. Sharon Jensen. That way the employer immediately sees your name.
Abbreviation,
yes. Thank you, Petra. So the competitions and personal features she didn't fill in, so we can remove those. Then she starts with work experience. Usually if you're a student and you have more student experience than work experience, you should start with your education. But if you have more work experience than education, or you worked the last years, then you should start with work experience. That she did all right. So let's look at this. I already see the same word, employer, 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 employer. Like that was about 10 times the word employer. That takes up a lot of space already. I mean, that's redundant. That's just, that can be removed. In every, everywhere you can remove that word already, the word employer, so you get my drift. Then you look at the years, so we should count back. She still used this to apply in 2008. That's what I know. So where is 2008 in this? Yeah, so there's a gap now between 2003 and 2008. Is a gap. That's important, because even if you've been unemployed since 2008, what have you done from 2003 to 2008? Unless she was unemployed then too. So I'm not sure about that. I would have to ask. So there's a gap. We have to explain that gap. That's the first gap. Basically, if you're applying until current day, you should explain it until today. So you should account for 14 years from 2003 to 2017. Should, if she still wants to apply, she should explain this gap. So let's see if the years are logical. So we go going reverse in time, 2003, 1997, 97, 96. Huh, there's another gap. There's a gap. From what's it called? Yeah, correct me if I'm wrong. Oh wait, there's another gap. See, it's years. The way you number the years. I mean, I'm not saying that is the way to go with the resume, because it takes up a lot of space. There are a lot of ways to do this better. But I'm just going with her resume for this example. If you're going with years, you have to be very careful not to skip. So what we're missing here is 1994 to 1995. We're missing. Then we're missing 1994, 1992. Till 1994. We're missing. No, sorry, 1993. Yeah, it is calculus, buddies. That's why you need math in school to do this sort of stuff. That is missing. 1992, 1991. Then we're missing 1989. 1989 till 1991. There's also a gap. You see that? I mean, it didn't look like there was, but if you start looking closely, you're gonna see the gaps. And then there's another gap. No, there's no gap there. 81, 72, 70. Then there's another gap from 1969 till 1970. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying that every gap is really there, but if you're going with the accurate timeline, then either you should change the numbers correctly to match. But now there's all kinds of gaps appearing. It's 1964, 1965, 1965, 1969, 1970. Okay, I think we have the gaps, but I'm just going to look at the other years since we're there. 1969, 2007, it's a different computer classes. Mm-hmm. Well, I started working with computers in the 90s. So that this lady started in 1969. Patron, that sounds to me a bit like maybe she reversed the 69 into 96. She time traveled, yes. It probably is this, 1996 till 2007. I think that's, so that's another error. And if I see this, an employer will see that too. They will think, whoa, she has... Because otherwise, she would have over 48 years of computer knowledge. Mm-hmm. That's a lot. So I think this is just reverse numbering. That is really sloppy. I mean, yeah, that could have been corrected already. So then we have here 1982, 1989. And then I think this is also time travel. This is 1989 back to 1992. So that should probably be 1992 to 1989. As you can see, then you still have some gaps. This is also a space that shouldn't be there. The word hobbies is misspelled in Dutch. Side functions, side jobs is one word. It's also a spelling mistake. So... there's a lot of sloppiness going on in this resume. So you see all these gaps, buddies. That's not good. And then if I look at the actual experience that I see, she started off with a company which I renamed into ABC, but if I'm an employer and I don't want to see the companies that you worked for, I want to see the jobs you worked for. Here is the word function. It's also a redundant word. You can just write the function name. You start with the function. That's a start with your function. It's a long word, so I'm going to split this up. This is the function, and this is the company, and it's the place where she worked. So that's basically how you do it. She has two different functions at that company, because it says environment care employee and magazine employee and sales employee. That's three functions. And she said all work that needed to be done. That's really general. So I have no idea what the work was that she did. This is completely redundant information. Responsibilities, that's also a redundant word. Managing the department, clothing and textile. Catching new employers and training them. So, yeah, catching them, receiving, yeah. So this description that she wrote here that does not match any of the functions that are described. So if you have three functions, just choose the function that is best suited to the job. Mm-hmm. So she probably was a, I don't know, department manager at ABC in Netterdam. And then you can write what you did. You managed employee management. Let's see, employee management. Yeah, just look at that. It's much shorter and much more clear. You can even put that in one sentence. I'm just winging it now because it's not unclear. I should contact her and explain what did she do? Which of the three functions why doesn't her job description match the three functions that she did? Or you have to specify all three functions. But then I would cut this up, the years, and I would say 1997, 1998, it was function 1, 1998, 1999, I was function 2, and then I was function 3. But just don't put it all in there and let us figure it out. So this is really confusing. And if I see 1996, 1997, she worked at two companies in Netterdam, call-in employer, just somebody you call in, work, ATF employee. I have no idea what ATF is. So that's another thing. If you write this, you have to write it full on, full out, so it doesn't give any confusion of what this is. So I would have to call this woman and say what's ATF stand for. So don't assume that I know that as an employer. Catering employee, she was here. All right. So from a management position, she was a catering position. That's really strange already. So those two jobs, and usually those last jobs are the most important jobs. That raises the question already. How did you go from catering employee to management employee? Or maybe you were a sales employee. It's not clear to me. So this would already raise flags and questions with me, and would annoy me a little bit as well. So let's all these things can be way shorter. So we're just gonna shorten this a little bit to one sentence, because what she put in first is probably the most important. So we'll put that in first. What you could do if you do these things, you could maybe make the function name that you had bold, so it stands out more. So just pick the one function that you think is most important and make it bold. Then you have the company, and you could even, but that's, yeah, the job descriptions, let's leave those out for now. You can even make that cursive, italic. I think italic is the word. See, then you have a visual division into function, company name, and place that you worked at. And that, yeah, that helps a little bit already. Then you have pattern drawing. There's no function name at all in this. Work, pattern drawing, new designs, and cutting them out. So if you're a pattern drawer, let's say you're a clothing designer, or let's make it a pattern designer. Pattern designer KL Netterdam. As you see, buddies, that cleans up nicely. So if you choose to name the functions, you should not forget your own job function. KL in Netterdam. Voila, there we go. You could also write department manager at ABC in Netterdam. Maybe that looks a bit nicer, but as you can see, that already makes it easier for the eyes to read. So this is a gap that needs to be explained. Then we have employer, function, teacher. So this person did have a lot of different functions. So that would, I would ask, hey, you were a teacher, you were a pattern designer, you were a caterer, and you were a manager. Wow, you had a wild life. Yeah? Teacher at MNO in Netherlands. Teaching clients to make clothes. Teacher, clothing teacher. So there's some design. Maybe there's. This is caterer. Caterer, that's the only one that's different, because this then could be a sales manager. Maybe clothing. Clothing sales manager or a cashier, I don't know. Clothing sales manager, caterer is a bit strange. Pattern designer, clothing teacher, that makes a bit sense. You could all do all these things the same way. You could write at caterer at DEF and GHI. That could mean that there's been a takeover of the company and that she still worked there, but that's not clear to me why she put in here two companies. Unless it's been two jobs. So I would just choose one name that's the most known, or that's if it's an old one is the old name and the other is the new name, I would choose the last name, the new name. Pattern designer at KL in Netterdam. It looks a bit nicer on the eyes already. Then we have another gap that needs to be explained. Function, administrative employer. So that has to be first, not the employer has to be first, like I said. At MNO, same company. in Netterdam. Light administrative work. Okay. So this career of this lady has gone up and down so far, from clothing work to cater work to administrative work. So I would ask, what would you prefer the most, if I would invite her? Then we have another gap to be explained. Let's see. Birth of daughter. Oh, that's a nice one. Birth of daughter. Taking care of my daughter and volunteers work. Well, she doesn't specify which volunteers work and where. So that can go out. And birth of daughter is not really something that you put in your resume. So let's take that out. Because that's something you could put in at your personalia, yeah? Which is also your personal details. You could say status, marital status, unmarried, one daughter. Easy as that. It should not be in your resume. Or don't mention it at all. Just what you prefer, just what you want to be known. So that means that from 1972 till 1972 till 1991 needs to be explained what she did. Apparently she was a volunteer at ... probably Netterdam, but it's very sloppy to be unclear, so you have to choose to be either really specific, but it cannot be a guessing game. And as you see, I'm guessing here already in her work experience. Here she was making clothes on freelance basis. So put in your function. You are freelancer in Netterdam. Now in Netterdam, I forgot to make it cursive or italic. See, if I have to be specific, I have to be it myself too. Netterdam. So it could, let's look at those gaps again. It could be that this gap is unintentional. Maybe she just meant 1993 to 1995. That's just a gamble that I'm going to take to get rid of the gap, because gaps look really unprofessional. So if we make 1992 to 1993, remove this gap, and suddenly, and then we would have to explain this gap could be unemployed, but what have you done? So you would have to put in something here. Something, maybe she did freelancing, volunteering, because that's a question that you're gonna get, what are you doing right now? What have you been up to? So that's how I got rid of the gaps. Freelancer in Netterdam. Then we have the 1969-1970. Let's remove that gap too by making this 1970. I can just do this and then verify with the customer if this is correct or not. So are you still with me, guys? I know this is tedious.
Yes, is this part of the Greek scan, or is this after somebody said I wanted
to... this is partly quick scan, but also after the quick scan, then I'm going to change it. If I would just quick scan it, I would just point out that to this woman that I would probably have to rewrite her whole resume, and then she would have to pay me to do that. But for the buddies out there who are still watching, still clinging on, I'm just going to go through it to the end. Because now I'm curious if I can fit this into one page. So, here another case of naming two companies. Just choose one, which it is now. And the word for company, employer, should not be in there. Function, upcoming coupons. I'm also love a hairdresser. If it's a job, you should make it a capital the function. Let's cut it, paste it in front of the company again. It's really boring, buddies. At PQR in Netterdam. Function, cutting out stuff and things. Oh yeah, that's a nice one. That's a nice one, buddies. Let's make this bold. Just to have some variety. I mean, you don't have to make it bold, but I like it for this job. Function that we covered. Work. Putting on fabric. Cutting out patterns out of cardboard. Pattern parts. Putting on fabric. Drawing and cutting. A lot of cutting. And then she writes the magical thing you should never use in a resume, etc. And so forth. It's the word for etc. If you write etc., you're basically saying, I'm too lazy to tell you, figure it out yourself. So that's a big no-no. And this is not a good sentence either. That has to be go-go. So, salesperson, just basically the same thing, salesperson. Person, the word for employer can go. Salesperson. At VWX in Netterdam. Voila. Function, selling clothes and keeping the store neat. Sure, I'm sure you did that. Then we have 64 to 64. Also, salesperson and register cash cashier. So let's, for the variety, choose cashier. But put it in capital K and capital M, because it's a job. Cashier at YZ in Netterdam. This person stayed in Netterdam all alive. Work, sales and cashier stuff. So there we go. Hi, buddies, look. We already put it on one page this way. It looks much neater than we started out. Don't you think so? Yes, I think so. So, we can even do an extra space there. And we can do an extra space here. And we can do an extra space there. So, let's look at the educations. Educations and courses. Let's remove the cursive, because it's already bold. Oh, let's remove it. If it wants to be removed, there it goes. Here is the timeline problem. That's a great one. As you can see, if I put on my underwater screen again, you see there's a couple of spaces. This is a tab. And here there's a lot of tabs. It doesn't really match up now. So we got to fix that. So either by making it all tabs. Basically, also, buddies, since we're doing this, if she sent it in as a Word document, but it's very professional to make it into a PDF. And it's very easy. You just go file and export as a PDF. And then you have suddenly you have a shiny PDF file. And I'm using a free text editor called LibreOffice, which you can download for free. You can make PDFs for free. And that way, it looks really cool. If you send it to an employer, you already enhance your chances by making it into a PDF. Mm-hmm. So, what did she do from 96 to 2007? Different computer courses. All right, that's nice, but you have to specify where. So, was there some institutes? Was it homeschool? Was it online? Where? Huh? You have to specify those things. You cannot get away with different computer courses. You have to specify which ones you did. And this is completely redundant information. I'm going to take that out, because it doesn't look professional. 1992-1998. The Professional Education Entrepreneurs Fashion and Clothing. Alright. If this was professional, then you should make it the capital letters, because that looks more professional. But you also should explain where it was. Yeah? For example, in Netterdam. At the fashion school, I don't know, fashion school. You cannot leave that important information out. So that's again that sloppy. So I would have to ask her. I said, "Hey, where did you do your education, and what was the name of the school? Not only the name of the education." Same goes for this. Coupeaux, clothing and costumier. As here she did write it with capitals, but the word costumier, that's you write this with a C, and the E is in the wrong way. Even the spelling, it's like this. So if I look at this from a professional standpoint, I see that you did that education for 7 years. 7 years, buddies. And after 7 years you write costumier wrong. So you did. So I would say, hey, Missy, you studied costumière for 7 years and you don't even know how to spell it. What's up with that, buddies? What's up with that, Petra? Mm-hmm. It's very sloppy. Mm-hmm. And again, where did she do this? Netterdam. And what was the name of the university or the school? The name of the school. So very sloppy. Mm-hmm. Very sloppy, buddies. But let's go to hobbies. I already corrected the spelling mistake. She misspelled it. Let's remove the underscores. At least see if what can we do with the hobbies. The exploration of the computer. Really? What does that mean? Walking around the computer with a big magnifying glass, exploring it. That's really weirdly written. Huh? It could just be, I don't know. What's the word? PCing? Computering. Computering. Biking, reading, drawing. I would leave the computer out of it. Just biking, reading, drawing. Reading. I have my doubts about that, because if you people who read a lot, they don't make a lot of those sloppy mistakes usually. So biking and drawing, that makes more sense to me. Put an extra space here. Oh yeah, the side functions. Note list, making notes at meetings. Same thing is, what kind of meetings? Anonymous alcoholic meetings, city council meetings, cooking club meetings. So what kind and when? When did you do this? So because it's not specified, I'm going to remove that. And with that, buddies, we have a perfect resume for Sharon Jansen. Mm-hmm. How awesome is that? If you look at this, it looks much better than what we started out with. So, I don't know how long this... How long have I been talking?
I don't know.
Let's see.
Probably very long.
So, buddies, it was a long sitting. And I hope... I hope that you at least realized how important it is to have your resume checked out by a professional text writer. Because if you don't, you're in trouble. As you can see, it's very perfectly clear to me why this lady hasn't found a job in 9 years, why she never got invited in 9 years. It's very clear to me. And hopefully it's also clear to you. And maybe if you hear people out there saying the next time, well, I applied for over 100 jobs and I get rejected every time, I don't know why, then think of this video and please refer them to me and say, have a text writer, have a copywriter look at your resume. Because chances are there's some stuff in there that could probably need some tweaking. So, enough with that. I hope this was learnful for you guys, helpful. Let us know in the comments. Paintwear, any final thoughts?
No. Thank you for watching.
See you next time, Bennies.
Oh, wait a minute. Don't be clicking the next video yet. If you like our content, yes, like, subscribe, support us on Patreon. Yeah, that was it.